In there and all right, good morning. As people start as folks start loading on and joining us this morning, I'm seeing we're up to pre-registered over 1,000 people this morning. So obviously the celebrity guest interviewee is the reason for the largest pre-registered group we've had so far. She keeps disappearing in and out of the screen for us, so we're going to give some time for people to get on. We're at 5. Kate's going to let me know, but I think we're at 6:50 or so right now, Kate. So we'll give a little time. And we are really excited about today's Friday Town Hall webinar. This is week number 6, I believe. And as you raise your hand and say hello, we appreciate that. Susan, hello. Lots of people raising their hands. All right. And we'll get to that number. Kate, you give me the thumbs up when we're there. You don't mind?
Yep, still kind of coming in. There's a lot of people.
Good, good, good. I don't know if anybody saw Mike DeWine, the governor of Ohio's press conference yesterday. He had like this yellow legal pad. He kept flipping through the pages. I feel like that today. I've got like all these notes and real sophisticated on a white legal pad as opposed to all typed up in front of me. So, all right. Okay, I'm seeing, Kate, that the, you know, we have the 1,000 pre-registered. Well, we're bumping back up. Saw it sort of slow down there for a second. Like to
yeah, I'll let you know when it slows. I think maybe
like
just 30 seconds.
So.
I'm waiting for my groupies to come on.
Helen, isn't everybody one of your groupies?
I don't know, but those people that text me in the middle of the night right now.
That's
with great
dedication.
Things, with great things, with articles, with recipes, with, you know.
It looks like they're all on, Helen. They're saying hello. Yeah, they're already
I
here.
I see.
All right, Hobie, it looks like it's slowed down a bit. I'm giving you the go ahead.
All right, we're getting all the We Love Helens, so the groupies are coming. So, all right, so good morning again, everybody, and glad you're here. We're this week's town hall webinar. We've got, it's gonna be an interesting town hall. As we promoted, Helen would be here for an interview. I'm gonna interview her based upon some questions that that you've sent me, based upon, I mean, sort of strange interviewing my aunt who I talk to probably twice a day. So we'll see how this goes with what questions. I don't already know how she'll probably answer, but she, you know Helen, she surprises everybody. And then we've also have Kevin Patai and Lauren Morante have joined us from the marketing department, as well as we always have the producer of this program, Kate Lasorda, to make sure it all works, because every morning we do this, I'm always like, Kate, I can't get on. So we've got Kevin and Lauren. And the reason, just we're going to hijack Helen's interview, because this is sort of part of Helen's directive over the last couple weeks. We've been seeing so many of you agents being, over 6 weeks, be so innovative. It's amazing to pivot, to go from traditional ways of you doing business. And I could never imagine that we would get to the point where we're having, you know, over 500 virtual open houses last week throughout the company, all on your own sort of initiative. Quite honestly, Kate did a great job early on of giving us some video content and education content, which is still out there if you haven't seen it, on how to have a virtual open house or virtual showing using multiple platforms, whether it's Facebook Live, whether if it's Instagram, YouTube, some of our offices, I even forget the name of some of the sites. I know in PA they're using a site, I think it's called Yard Sign or something like that, that's more of a shared platform. Some people are using Zoom and doing screen sharing. I mean, I'm amazed at the innovation of our agents. And so a few weeks ago, as we were seeing this, Helen said, well, what else can we do, Hobie? You got to give more support to these agents. They got to build their collateral. She was right. And so we turned it back to marketing. And Lauren and Kevin and their whole marketing team have, both with our website provider and some other assets, put together some support. You don't have to do anything different than you're doing, but we want to help promote your virtual open houses and virtual showings even more than they already are. So I asked Lauren if she wouldn't mind sharing with us some of those materials, some of those assets, and some things that are being launched, I believe, this morning, so that all of you can, not only this weekend, but in weeks to come, we can give you more support for those virtual opens. So that introduced Lauren Morante, and she's got control of the Zoom.
Yes. Hi, everybody.
Hi, Lauren.
Nice to be here with you all. So I'm going to share my screen. So like Hobie said, actually as of 9 a.m. this morning, we released a new feature on the website that we're really excited about. So now customers are officially able to search for virtual open houses on our website. So I just wanted to walk through that new feature with you today and how you will be able to feed your virtual open houses to the website. And then I'll get into how you can use marketing materials that we've provided for you guys to be able to promote your virtual open houses from there. So right now I'm going to be showing you everything on our stage website. So like I said, this is live, but just for demo purposes, this is on our stage site. So as you can see, the homepage looks pretty much the same, except this great banner up here. So we've always had this checkbox here to only show open houses when someone searches from the homepage. The only difference now is the search results that you see. So if I were to search for West Mifflin, PA up here, you'll see that the map still works. Everything is the same. The key difference here is the visual that you see on the side that indicates what type of open house you're looking at. So this is what a virtual open house would look like, plus six more. And then it also indicates in-person traditional open houses as well. So when you see labels like that on listings, that's also going to carry over everywhere else we show these listing cards on the website. It's also going to carry over into HomeFinder emails as well. So anyone who signed up for an open house email alert through HomeFinder will also see these labels in there. So let's take a look at what it looks like on a listing page. So when you're on a listing, customers can now see in one simple list all the types of open houses in one place, whether it's in person or virtual. And really what can happen now is we have a button for someone to join the virtual tour. And when they click on that, that would be the link that you have created for your virtual open house. Which would be, like Hobie said, your Zoom meeting, your Facebook event, maybe it's the page for your Facebook channel, your Facebook Live page. It could be whatever technology you have chosen, that would be the link that shows. And when someone clicks on that button, it would simply open up in another window and they could join in your virtual open house. So this is all listed in one simple place. Great. So I know that you're probably all wondering how we're getting this fed into the website. So the answer to that is we are feeding these through the MLS. I don't know if anyone's noticed this. It's definitely a newer feature that's been added slowly over time, but several MLSs now have a field for virtual open houses. So that allows you to enter the details of the open houses you normally would, but also provide a link. So I want to show you the list of MLSs that are currently offering this virtual open house field. And so if you do not see your MLS on this list, don't panic. Basically, if you're not on this list, you can still feed your virtual open house link to our website by using the open house admin tool and web admin that everyone should already be used to using. So there's really no difference there. We've simply updated the open house admin to allow you to also add in virtual open houses in addition to the traditional open houses.
Lauren, can I add something that on sure. this that for all agents, like we don't want you to be stressed out about how you add in where you are. This week we met with all the regional managers, state leaders, and they've communicated, if you haven't seen it already, you'll see it through your managers today, should have come out yesterday, that all admins, you know, who are working for us in their remote access we're creating for each market an entry form that is an agent. If you're having a virtual open, you just give the address, you'll say whatever's needed for your MLS, and you just email that to your administrative assistant, and he or she will enter it into the Modelist for you. If you don't have a model, if Modelist doesn't have a field, he or she will enter it into the admin for Howard Hanna. You can do it yourself if you want, but don't feel like, oh, it's one more thing I have to learn right now. Right. Our administrative staff is prepared and ready to support you with this.
Right, absolutely. So going back to the website here, so just to reiterate the places that your virtual open houses will now be displayed. So they will show in search results on the website. They will show on listing pages here. They will show in Home Finder open house email alerts. And one more new thing that I wanted to show everyone was we now have a landing page on our website for marketing purposes that is dedicated to promoting virtual open houses only. So I'm going to scroll through here. The great thing about this page is it truly is dedicated to just virtual open houses. So this search bar here will allow someone while they're staying at home to come to our website, and whether they're on this page or on our homepage, they can search virtual open houses only because they know that's all they can do right now. And then down here, they will see this carousel that they can click through that will feature, it should refresh, it will change the list of listings that shows here that are featured every time they visit the page, and it will show listings that are virtual opens near them. So this is truly customized to the person that's viewing the page, and it's customized to show virtual open houses. So this is a page that we will be using heavily in our corporate marketing efforts. So on social media, if we're talking about this, we will be linking to this page because we know that it allows customers to immediately search virtual opens. And we want to encourage you guys to use this page as well. It's just going to be howardhanna.com/virtual-open-houses. And an exciting thing I want to tell you is that this page is also available on your agent websites. So the way that you would get to that page on your website is your agent website URL. So that's your agentname.howardhanna.com. And then it would just be the remainder of this URL here, /virtual-open-houses. So everyone has that page on their website. So if you want to share that on your social media, that would be a great way to capture people. This is where everything is. So Hobie, before I move on to marketing pieces, is there anything else that you want to touch on?
Just two things, if I could. One, because I'm seeing some of the questions, frame of reference and frame of mind, like you showed that first screen where it showed virtual open house and then live open house. And I already saw the email saying, well, I didn't think you were allowed to do live open houses in certain markets. You're not, like, that's not what we're promoting, but we're right. Not turning that off. What I want to be clear is that when we do get back to allowing live open houses, I firmly believe that virtual open houses will not go away. I think the world we will live in and what the technology of consumers are seeing, we're seeing tremendous amount of consumer traffic to these virtual open houses. I think you as agents and customers will maybe do a virtual open house then and then have a live a week later or in concert. So we don't want to turn off that button because we also know with the staged openings and openings in different markets, we may get back to live open houses with new instructions in some markets sooner than others. But this is really to promote virtual, and we're not asking people to do the live open houses today. That's one. Right. Two, for your mindset, again, and frame of reference, think about the virtual open houses and what we're doing on our website as just like it's a traditional open house promotion. And if you went to look at a regular open house, you'd have the address, you'd see the photos, and then you'd go see the home. So what you're going to put into the Modelist or the back end is that there's a virtual open house and the platform that you're using, whether it's Zoom, whether it's YouTube, whether it's Facebook Live, it asks for that to be part of it. So when you go to register, that's where you see the open house. So it's sort of like, yes, I see the photos. Now I'm going to go to the virtual at Facebook or wherever it is when I register. So it sort of takes you there automatically. And the last thing is, do what you're comfortable with. So like I said, so many of you have been so innovative and creative. We're not here telling you that you should use YouTube over Facebook, over Instagram, over Zoom share, screen share, or Matterport, or any of the different features. keep doing what you're doing. This is just a way when people come to howardhanna.com, they can find all the virtual open houses. They can look and say, hey, I want to look in all of the South Hills of Pittsburgh. So how rather than hunt and peck and just look at Facebook, we can feed it. And finally, this will also feed to realtor.com automatically when you enter. And we're working with our other partners, like how to look for more to come on Open to Close and Real Scout and other of our tools that will begin to connect. But we don't want to overwhelm you today. We just want you to realize if we get the listing put into the admin side or the MLS and feed it, now we can have one singular advertising source in place for everybody to find your virtual opens. So, but I think from that, Lauren, let's show them some of the additional marketing assets outside the website that are live now.
Okay. So we're just going to run through a checklist first of just some simple ways to promote your virtual open house, and then I'll run into the example so you can see what everything looks like. So number one, use sign writers. We have two new designs that are going to be available to you. Share the listing on Facebook. This one is my favorite thing on the list here. I think it's something that is minimal effort with some great results. So I'll get into an example of that so you can see why. Posting social graphics, enhance your posts with an animated GIF sticker, send a virtual open house e-card, and then a bonus thing, this is actually something that we released a while back and I'll show it on the screen in a minute, but we created a sample marketing plan for the week leading up to your virtual open house. And this is a great way to just kind of look in a calendar view of what activities you can be doing every day and how to do those things to promote your virtual open house on your own with no help. So here are the sign writers. And then this is what I wanted to touch on here, sharing your virtual open house on Facebook. So Kate did this example for us. And so now that this feature is live, think how many great things someone can see just by looking at your listing page on howardhanna.com. They can see photos of the listing. They can read about it. They can see the school district. They can see all of, not even just this weekend's virtual open house, but if you have open houses scheduled ahead of time, they can see that complete list. There's a contact form where they can contact you and ask about it ahead of time. So think how much impact this would have just to go on Facebook and to now share the link to that listing. And so what Kate did here was she used the caption space to say live open house this Sunday, 12 to 12:30, click listing below for details. So all she did was paste in that listing and she added in a few bits of information and she posted it. I think this is a great thing that we can do going forward. And like I said, it's super easy. You don't have to create a graphic because it pulls in that listing photo for you. And it shows the address at the bottom. I just think it's a great piece. So that would be my number one tip for today. Okay. Social graphics. So if you want to go above and beyond, these are some things that we've created in marketing that you can use to enhance your posts. So Kate actually pulled together a training video on how to use the things like on the far left, you see this editable frame looking post. So we will be giving you the link to that video today if you need a refresher on how to use that. Anything here that says editable is a publisher file. So we set up the design for you. You can totally type over it, delete things, move things around, but we've set this up for you to help you promote yourself and your virtual opens. The graphic on the far right, I also want to call attention to because I think everyone's been doing a great job of posting links and photos and everything on their Facebook and Instagram pages. But something that's important to remember is that doesn't mean much if you don't have followers. So something that we want to encourage you all to do is to not only remind people to follow you on your various channels, but also follow my office. Because a lot of our offices now are doing these progressive open houses, and we also want to promote our offices, not just ourselves. So you guys can use that graphic and fill it in. You don't even have to have all of those channels that are listed there. You can delete whatever doesn't apply to you, but I think that's a great piece to use. Gift stickers. These are things that people have really enjoyed, and these three specific ones are about virtual open houses. So you can stamp this on your Facebook story, Instagram story, or even Snapchat. And then we have instructions up at the top there for how you can find those. This is a dynamic e-card that we've had available in GoHanna and also in the New York Marketing Store for a few weeks now. But this pulls in the listing photo and listing information, and it links to the listing page. So again, this is great that now once you have your virtual open house link on the listing page and you send people this e-card, when they click on it, they'll go there and they'll see all the listing information on top of the links to that virtual open house. And then last but not least, this is that sample marketing plan that I talked about. This is a PDF, it's 2 pages on GoHanna, and it just walks you through Monday through Sunday, how you can prepare leading up to a Sunday virtual open house. And obviously you can modify this if you have things that work for you. You don't have to follow this step-by-step, but this is great for someone that just doesn't know where to start. And so it references all the pieces that we have available in marketing. A lot of the feedback we've gotten is you guys give us so much great stuff, but we just don't know what to do with it. So this is exactly what this page is for here, to help you guys figure out when and how to use these things and how often. And then last thing here, I just wanted to show you on GoHanna, all this stuff is saved under Documents, Marketing, Marketing Campaigns, and then the Virtual Offerings folder. So we will be sending out an email later today that goes over all the stuff that I just went over with you in depth. And it will touch on both how to set up your virtual open house and then also touch on these marketing materials as well. So keep an eye out for that email. And it will have a lot of helpful links in there. So definitely hang on to that email. The links will take you to things like training videos, documents. They'll link directly to these pieces in GoHanna, so you really don't have to think twice about what you're supposed to do. So that's everything. Hobie, do you have anything to add?
Just a couple quick things. And Lauren, great job. Please share back with the entire marketing team. And Kevin, incredible. You turned all this around, I think, really in like 10 days, which is amazing. Just a couple things that I want to add just for the group. I'm looking at the questions that come in, and there's some great questions. We will come back with some additional training. Plus you're going to see the whole company this afternoon will get a whole packet sent to you. We're going to email it to you that has links to videos, that has examples of everything you've seen here that you can walk through. You can talk to your managers about how to best support things. But a couple questions that I thought I would just answer now. One is, there was a question about rules from MLSs and rules on signage. Has that been approved? Is this all approved to do virtual? Yes. Like, please know that everything we do is approved for us to conduct business. Number two, questions about where does it feed? Does it feed to Zillow? If your modelist feeds to Zillow, then you got to talk to your modelist director. Then maybe the virtual open house information will feed to Zillow. However, we're not sending it to Zillow from our feed, because we know that those leads get resold to other agents, so they're not coming back to you. And then three is a question that was like, okay, how could I take it one step further? How do I collect, when people come to my virtual open house, how to collect their emails? How do I collect, get them to register, give me a phone number? We didn't want to overwhelm that today. What I will tell you is look for some training webinars next week coming out from Kate and her and the education team, because we are working with open to close to be virtual in a sense and allow you to collect some data. Some of you may have already been using that, but we'll bring that to everybody next week. So just some things there, sort of walk before you run. Hopefully if you're already way ahead of the curve and doing everything, this gives you some additional collateral to support your virtual open houses. If you're new to this, it's real simple. Give it to your admin, let them put it into the model list, pick your platform, and away we go. And then we'll build upon it in weeks to come to give you more support. So stay patient in that sense, and we'll definitely help you out. All right. If Kevin, I don't know if you have anything, but before we jump to the interview with Helen, Kevin, do you have anything to close on the platform?
No, just one simple like confusion that's been out there that I kind of like to clear up a little bit is a lot of people are asked, like, can it be, does it have to be a recording, or I mean, does it have to be live? Can it be a recording? I've since this virtual world has come to the forefront, I've kind of looked at it as three different items. I've looked at it as you have a virtual tour, which we've pretty much always had on our listings. So, you know, basically a slideshow, right, of your property. Then you have a virtual showing, and I look at a virtual showing as a one-on-one. So that's what we added to the website to say, hey, I'd love to see this house. Can I set up an appointment tomorrow at 4 o'clock to see it with you? And that's that one-on-one showing. And then you have the open house. So the open house to me is what an open house is, you know, up until today, a group of people seeing at one time on one day. So does it have to be live? No, I don't think it has to be live. It'd be nice if it's live, but you do what you're comfortable with. But I think that that's the differences between a showing versus a tour versus an open house. So, but other than that, you know, it's ready to use and add those in there, because people are going to be looking this weekend and hopefully they'll sell some more houses with it.
Yeah, that's great. And like all this language, it's also new.
Absolutely.
The industry will figure out what we call all these things in years to come. So, all right. Well,
Lauren, can I just say before you get off? I don't know if you're getting off. Can you show the sign writers again?
One more. Let me click back here.
I don't mean to jump in, but I'm so impressed with it. Look at that. Look at those colors, guys. And this was just us saying, you come up with it. And actually, when they were ordering them 2 days ago, I said, you even get to pick which ones you like best. Because all of the ones that they did were great. But I just think the designs pop out. And that was really important, too. It's not just another, you know, sign writer that hangs on a house. So thank you. That's all. Yeah.
Thank you. And on the sign riders, there will be some, Helen, correct me if I'm wrong, because you, we will have some that are distributed to offices next week as they ship. And then, but you can go to GoHanna today. And if you want to order your own riders, whether a group of agents want to get together, whether it's one, whether it's 10, whatever, they are there for you to order, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. They won't be in for a week, I don't think, but I think next Thursday is the date. But actually they will be shipped to agents. I don't know how our team's going to do this, but they told me they could. They will be shipped to agents that had virtual opens this Sunday. That's how we'll start. We're going to send each of you one to say thank you for doing this and sort of leading the pack on it. So if you have a virtual open this weekend, we'll hopefully get one to you directly next week. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Great. All right. Well, I will say thank you to Kevin and Lauren. I know Kate has a bunch of education that's all tied to this, so she's been part of the team too. You guys are rock stars as always, and thank you for putting everything together. Make sure you let the rest of the marketing department know if they're not on here. I know so many people touch this, so yeah. Thank you for reacting so quickly. You know, I'll brag. I talked to 4 brokers around the country who I said, you know, this is what we put. I was on a call with the leading RE board, and I said, here's what we're working on this week that'll be launched. And they were like, no one can get that done that quickly. Our website provider won't let us make those kind of changes. And I said, well, not at Howard Hanna. You give our marketing department a challenge and, you know, presto, it comes up. Now, I'll try to give you a break next week, let you just catch up. So thank you both, and I know everybody appreciates it. Thank you.
All right, Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Bye, everybody.
Thanks, everybody, great job.
All right, Kate, I know you may stay with us and be behind the scenes, but we're going to get started. So as I get ready to interview Helen, and I've got, you know, pages of notes here, I thought I'd start off with just this week. And you know, all these weeks are crazy. I get that. And full of stress and so forth. But I want to talk about some positives of the week that I saw. Well, first is that Michigan is open today. Michigan's open for business. I saw some Facebook advertising posts from our agents in Michigan said, back to work after 8 weeks. And so I'm hoping that as some of these states' requirements open up a little bit, and we gain some confidence and come back into the market, start talking to our clients and customers. And we know Michigan's been one of the hardest hit states in terms of in terms of the coronavirus, in terms of the governor really shutting things down, in terms of real estate being non-essential from the very beginning, and really some strict, not even back and forth of virtual, just strict. So Michigan, we're excited for you. We know you're back to work. Now, at the same time, yellow, the new yellow zone, as I read these things in Pennsylvania, and we know that we've got counties and markets that are now open for business in Pennsylvania to work smart and intelligently and healthy. And so we've had meetings this week. So that eases, and it's not just that we haven't been selling real estate in all of these markets, because I'll talk about that in a second, even with the not being able to, our agents are being creative and supporting their clients and customers. But I think it's a psychology and a confidence, not only for ourselves, but our buyers and sellers, that they feel a little safer to come back into the market. So that's great information. New York has laid out their plan for more of an opening in this past week. And I know that Freddie and Al have really been working with the governor's office and figuring out directive and how we can come back safe from work. And, you know, so I think we're seeing more opening and so forth. Ohio announced that retail is opening, and they have rules for retail and restaurants starting next week. And actually, I thought I'd share that for the Northeast Ohio modelist, the showings this week, which leads to buyer activity, showings this week are at the same level they were the week before we went into shutdown. So this sort of has come back at a nice level there. Traffic on the website is up for the last 3 days, which is a nice tick up. So maybe that means more people are coming back. And then our mortgage company, as Duffy mentioned last week when he came on, you know, jumped out and extended all of our credit lines and has more pre-approval and also pending pipeline of mortgage business, which is great. Those are all really positive things. And one other thing is this, which is I'll lead into this, Ann Helen, to this question with you. I looked at a report this morning you and I were talking about that we've started to look at on our executive level, where we're trying to see who's doing business out there. Because we get the overall report, right, and say, okay, numbers are off. But we start to look and see agents, no matter if they're in New York or Michigan. You know, I looked at the report and looked at Michigan, for example. And Kayla Dominique, who's in Jackson, she had 3 sales this week. Susan Amwale had a sale for $950. Now, Michigan opened today or yesterday. They didn't happen yet. Like, they happened earlier in the week and they turned them in. I see the same thing in New York from that report, seeing agents like Jay Groh having 3 sales, Philip Wagner selling a house for $639, Debbie Jacob having $1.5 million in sales. And we're doing this in markets that you're doing it. The agents are doing it with a little confidence and quietly, or even in, you know, PA, seeing that Ryan Sedlock had 7 sales this week and Dina Spagnola had $1.3 million week. Like, people are doing business and they're doing it creatively, even where it's like you can't show live. So Helen, starting off with, like, what are you seeing and hearing about and the psychology of agents? How do we have that discussion? You're muted, Ann Helen.
No, I'm not. Hi, everybody. Part of this is, and I don't know that everybody understands what the management side, meaning all of your office managers and your regional manager and your state leaders are all involved in, is this process of 10 states with 10 different sets of regulations. And then within the states, some of our boards have made requirements that don't match in the other parts. And so what I think is, I think it's a choice of a lot of people as to how they perceive what they do. And I do not mean whether that's they're physically showing or not, because in New York, we're essential, but we can't show houses. We can go stand in a house and do a virtual tour, but we can't show them. We've been able to show in Ohio since day one. North Carolina is by county. So I think it's personally what you believe you're capable of doing. And we found a lot of sales associates that believed that they could work virtually. And I've been saying, we thought we were about 35% ready. We were all about 70% ready, by the way, because we had all these tools at our fingertips. Some people were using them. Some people are just learning them. But it is a personal decision of how you perceive what you're going to do each day. Are you going to send out positive messages, Are you going to use virtual tours? Are you going to stitch together photos you have to create virtual tours where you didn't have them? And some agents have just been, I think, incredibly great at doing their job without doing it in person. Mm-hmm. They're still listing and they're still selling. And how are they doing it?
On that end, Helen, can I ask you, because a question that did come in, that two of them that came in, they sort of were the same. I'm parting them together. One was an agent saying, I have one listing. I'd like to do more. I'd like to do a virtual open house, but I don't feel like doing it on the same house every week. How can I work with other agents? And tying that, there's also another question that was sort of like, I'm paraphrasing, more to the point of that the agent, I don't want to say who, said that they still, no matter what their state opens up, they're feeling a little bit compromised. They're feeling a little bit afraid, they, the agent, to come out and work yet. And I'm just wondering, you know, from your mindset, how can we say to those agents that we can still help them help their clients, and say to maybe the newer agents or the ones or agents who do feel comfortable, how do we match them up? Like, what would be your suggestion to agents on overcoming a fear, or also saying, how do you approach, as a newer or agent only with one listing, how do you approach others to do more for them? What would be your recommendation?
I have been very clear that everybody should only do what they're comfortable with. All right. And I do not want anybody breaking regulations. These are not laws, by the way. There are no laws. We've had no fines. We've had nobody go to jail. We've had no license actions in any states that we're in. Okay. No matter how tough the regulations have been. Michigan, which was the worst, we haven't had any. So, but I think you can only do, I don't think you should do virtual tours if you're not comfortable doing it. But if you go to your manager, there may be an agent in your office who has skills doing those. And I think the two of you could work together. Right. Because we do have a responsibility to our sellers who are saying, sell the house.
Right.
You know? And so I think you have to work through your manager to help you do that.
So I'm going to take that further, because it plays off the questions there. And that is right. We got to get managers and putting agents together, matching people up. Because if you're not comfortable and confident, again, we don't want you to be, we don't want you to put yourself in harm's way, and if you feel like harm's way. But the other is that some questions to the point of, somebody just asked, our house is closing. Sure, you can do virtual, you can sign electronically, buyers still want to touch and feel, our house is closing. And I think there is, I know like in one state, there was a rumor that you couldn't close anything written after a certain date, which was a board mantra, got crazy. There's nothing in writing from the governor. Barristers have been closing all along. And then, so the part of the question I'd ask you is, are we still closing in states, even on deals that are written recently? And number two, some people said, well, this will lead into the next question, because we hear a lot about buyers. Should I list right now? Won't that be a disservice to my seller? So two questions, closing and listing.
Well, let's really separate those a bit, because you have to have the listing before you have the closing. But we'll start with the closing first. With rare exceptions, we are closing everywhere. And by the way, some of the date things said that you couldn't, if it was written after a certain date, you couldn't do inspections, et cetera. And people interpreted that to be closed, because it was taken too far.
Are there still inspectors out there inspecting?
Depends on the market area. Some inspectors by state, we had them doing it virtually, you know, the first week in Ohio when they weren't even shut down yet, or didn't realize if they were going to be shut down. In Pennsylvania, some have. Others went back to work last week, though I think they were working before that, because they considered themselves contractors.
Yep.
And so that's the other problem, is that the rules from state to state and how they're interpreted, you know, you can take photography. This makes no sense to me. A photographer can go to a house in the state of New York, but our agents can't show the house in the state of New York. Makes no sense. But yes, we can close. We are closing. I have to say that I think our mortgage and closing companies have just done phenomenal jobs. I mean, if you haven't, you're not allowed to go to them, I know. But if you were to go to them, you would see the ones that are inside have these plexiglass shields with a place you slide papers through. We're closing in tents. We're closing with drive-bys. And at Howard Hanna, we're not just closing anywhere, by the way, because we want to make sure the clients are protected. We're closing in places where we have the control to clean that night, et cetera. As an example, We're not closing in our financial services building. We're closing outside there because we have people physically allowed to work there. We're closing down the street at corporate where we don't have people working, and we have crews coming in to clean to make sure that that there's no germs being passed. So, you know, a little bit of everything, but yes, you can close. You can close, and that doesn't appear to be the problem. The problem sometimes is the appraisers and the inspectors, but that seems to be resolving itself almost everywhere. So if you sell a house, don't worry about closing it, right? On the other hand is the question of listing houses. And I think the impression is because this days on market has gotten so important and so big that we're concerned because we're going to have days on the market and it's going to get stale. Well, the problem with getting stale is that there's not time for anything to get stale because there's so few listings. And I think the agents that are having successes right now are agents who are listing, who are also having sales, or multiple waiting people to go into them. And because the inventory is so low, I looked at just West Penn yesterday, and the numbers were so low in West Penn. I looked at, we're looking at that in Albany, all right? Albany, they are listing. Their market is not as bad. And they were only off 35% last month. Syracuse closings were up last month, amazingly, in the same state as Buffalo and Rochester, which are dramatically down. A lot of it has to do with the listing side. So if you notice today, you know, I'm a gimmick person, so I've got my pin on that says if you list it, it will sell. I think that we are missing tremendous opportunities right now to be exposing houses to a market. We know we have buyers out there. We have, if you look at the numbers that are coming to these virtual open houses, there are buyers there that are waiting. People wouldn't be buying houses without seeing them if they didn't indeed need to buy housing now and want to buy it. But there's so little market. So we're also seeing people that looked at houses in February and March before we shut down that are coming back and buying those houses now because nothing else has come on. So I think really we're not providing our sellers with the kind of exposure we should be. So if it were me right now, I would be getting my house on. I would be using the time to get it ready. I would get it into Malta list, because what would be holding you back now, except in the few places in Pennsylvania and New York where we can't show yet, but we do see houses being sold. So I also think it gives us an opportunity to do a better job than we've ever done before.
Well, so I agree. And just anecdotally reading these, so Roman Zaguda from New York wanted to just share that he sold a house this week. And Roman, thanks for sharing this, that he sold the house this week, there was no showing. It was all done virtually. It was all done online. They put an HSA home warranty on the house which I think we should be doing more of upfront and promoting that, because it gave peace of mind that there was a warranty on the home for the inspection. And yes, the buyer did want to see the house, so I think he waived his home inspection, if I read this correctly, but he wanted to see the house. So Roman, because we can't really show in New York, I think the buyer and seller found a way to talk to each other after the contract was signed so that the buyer could just walk through the house and come back. So I think a lot of agents are doing things creatively where they're protecting themselves. They're doing it virtually, they're signing contracts. I know it's hard because we're used to being people, persons, and right there next to them. And you know, like Mary Sue Murray said, well, you know, I'm used to just closing the deal and being in front of somebody. I think that the whole world is going to adapt and change, and we can be creative, and we could meet somebody in a driveway in a state like Ohio and say, talk from car to car. I mean, there is creativity around this, and that's there. But going back to the listing, because Helen, staying on the listing for a minute, we talked about this yesterday at a meeting and I heard this from some agents that we're not bringing listings on. Buyer demand is huge. It's basic supply and demand. And we know Howard Hanna Marketing and agents, and that our value proposition is stronger and better. We talked about this, that if the inventory's soft right now and we have all these buyers, I personally think we need to challenge the market a little bit and be aggressive in terms of pricing that I think we can get for people. So because I think sellers want the most money they can get, and they won't worry about commission rate and commission cutters on listings if we firmly say I can get you more money. What's your take on that and how we justify that we can get more money for our sellers?
I think every study you're seeing nationally, every study you're seeing locally will show that prices are up. Sales units are down and prices are up. So why is that? Now, yes, we've had some great, really high price sales the last couple of weeks, and we're seeing a return to that market a little bit. And we're seeing it everywhere, by the way. But that's not pushing the prices up. What's pushing the prices up are the fact that there are no houses. And we could substantiate that. And so if you go in on a virtual listing appointment, I had a text from somebody, they have to jump off early for a virtual listing appointment. But if you go in for a virtual listing appointment or you go in for an in-person listing appointment and you use a CMA today, I don't know what you're basing it on. You can't be basing it on the CMA because you have to base it on what is there right now. 3 months ago, we had more inventory than we have now. The price you put has to be the price that we can get in the marketplace. So let me give you some examples of some strange things that we're seeing in New York. And I'm sorry, I can't remember the agent's name. It's a newer agent who was in the Fast Start class that I was on his first week in Fast Start. He had a sale last week. He couldn't find the people. He knew new people. He's never shown them the house, never been in a house to show. Understand? He has never shown a house in his career because his career is only 5 weeks old. Couldn't find them a house. He found an expired listing. The seller had been advised to take it off the market because of the pandemic. And he relisted the house and sold it. He sold it at asking price. He didn't sell it 10% under or 20% under. He sold it at asking price. In Pennsylvania 2 weeks ago, after the virtual tours in Fox Chapel, there were three offers on a house. One of those buyers has had an offer on the house for more than a month. They looked at it in February and March. They thought they could steal it. Guess what? They lost the house. Another buyer got it for more money. Very close to asking price. So I think we're seeing that, and that's what we need to substantiate to people. That's what we need to share. And I think a lot of you are afraid to share your success stories. You're afraid to put your sales in the market when you have them because you're afraid of some boogeyman that you've been told by someone is going to come out and get you. And I mean, really, I get these texts in the middle of the night that people are worried about their licenses, and we haven't had anybody that is under investigation. We haven't had any problems. So, and as I've said, we're in a serious health crisis. I doubt they have time to be out looking for an agent to see whether they put a house in the multi list. This is not about whether they've seen the house. Agents, some agents are afraid to put them into the multi list for fear that's breaking a rule. So I think if we don't control our destiny, if we don't get listings, we're going to have a terrible problem this summer. On the other hand, if right now, this week, next week, the week after, we outlist any of our competition, we price them to meet market demand, we give them unparalleled marketing that we're seeing right now, unparalleled what we're doing out there. Nobody can believe it. And I think if we do that, I think you're going to all have a great summer.
And Helen, two more questions around listings, and then we'll switch topics a little bit. But one is, they sort of tie together, but let's say that a lot of agents rely and have relied, in my opinion, maybe too much. I know you and I will agree with this, we'll agree with this. We've relied too much in our industry, especially the last few years, because the listing shortage has been there for a while. We rely too much on a CMA that has data from 6 months prior in terms of pricing. And so in today's market, basic economic supply and demand, how do you recommend, what's your thought around the CMA and how we're pricing when somebody is looking just at comp data being their only thing today? How would you recommend using a CMA to your benefit to support better pricing?
I've never been much of a CMA person, because I think CMA is an algorithm. It's an algorithm no matter how you do it. When you did it 30 years ago, it was an algorithm, but it was at least your algorithm based on your knowledge. Right. And today it's based totally on formulatic. And I think last year when we saw in Raleigh, North Carolina, that the number one listing company was a company that was an iBuyer. And for those of you in markets that don't have them, that means they buy houses from people. And they were there, they were using algorithms. And so we're competing with somebody who's gonna come in and buy your house in 3 weeks using the same algorithm. And that really doesn't make any sense. They're gonna tell you, you don't have to do anything, you don't have to clean up, you don't have to do that. We'll come in and just buy it as it is, and this is the price. So I think we have to distinguish ourselves. And part of what I think agents who really succeed distinguish themselves is by knowing that the house behind us had purple carpeting and therefore the price was less. Or knowing that this carpet had hardwood floors that had been refinished. Not just because that doesn't go into an algorithm, the hardwood floors will go in, but it won't say that they were refinished in maple, which might be more popular than oak. And I think that's what makes the difference in all of us. And that's why this is such a great time to be using your extra time to be going and looking at everything in your market online every day. You don't have to tour to be able to get to know your market. So I think, to me, a house is also how the sun shines through the window, how it smells, how the furniture sits in a room. All of those things come into it. And that's what differentiates us. I was just seeing on the chat, there was a question about putting buyers and sellers together. And is that dangerous for us for the future? I think we have to be very careful, by the way. But that's the same thing as a CMA to me. That's what we're doing here. We're putting buyers and sellers together if we're saying all we can do is a CMA. So you look behind me. Pardon?
With that, I saw one of the questions was, what about, and I think agents think this way, well, because when we talk about challenge in the market, and I don't think you're saying not to know the market comps. I think I know you well enough, and you've trained me for all these years. I was never taught by you or my father to do a CMA the way agents today do. I was always taught to know your market, know the comps, know, like you just said, that the house next door may be sold for 200, and why could you justify, and why then could an appraiser justify 210, 215 for this home in a market because there's less supply, because you know that the kitchen's upgraded, they put granite in, and the kitchen that sold for 200 had vinyl tops. I mean, that's how I was always taught by both of you to list and sell and price. I think there's a fear today about appraisals maybe, that appraisals are gonna use market data from the past. And I don't wanna get too much into that because we're gonna have a whole class on how to, day on how to make sure we support the appraisers to show the difference of value. But we're talking about getting listings, and we're talking about creating that we can get more value for somebody's home. And I hope, I want to be careful we don't get too worried about the appraisal on the sales side, because the market will match. But if you tell somebody their house is worth 200 and you think in today's market you can get more and you give them that price, they may list, they may become a for sale by owner. They may just say thanks for the data and sell it themselves. So how do you answer that appraisal question, or that what's going to happen down the road if we don't use a CMA question?
Well, I think that goes back to my whole theory about what you choose to do. You know, you all see me write about this forever. What do you do when you get up in the morning? What shoes do you put on? How do you get yourself psyched for the day? If you want to worry about appraisers, you worry about appraisers. If you want to worry about what we're doing for our clients is to get them the most money for their house under the best terms. Right. You can't get them the most money for their house under the best terms unless you look at all aspects of it. And it isn't just whether it's an upgraded countertop. It's, you know, I live in a house that I would hope that the staircase behind me that some of you can see would add value to my house. It would never show in a CMA that I have a glass and bronze. That wouldn't show. What value would that give in a CMA? But if you walk into the house and you see the way the sunlight hits it, that gives it value. That's the same thing in every house you've ever been in. Why does somebody buy a house? Why does somebody buy a house? Because it smells good. All of those things. But to me, the most important data in a CMA is what's in your head. So today, if you were out in the marketplace today, and I told this to some of the classes, I would say to you, go see 70 houses in your first 3 weeks. I would say exactly the same thing right now. Go see 70 houses this week online. Go see them and look at them closely and call the listing agents and ask questions. Ask questions about that bedroom. Don't base it on just a CMA that says a room is 8.5 by 11, because if it is, that's a picture frame.
Okay, switching gears from listings, because I think we are driving a point home that we need listings, everybody, and we need to be talking to our friends, even if you're at home and you don't want to go out, having a phone call with your friends, your sphere, your past clients, talking about the demand of buyers and that we need listings, good things will come of that. Good things will come with that. But let's talk about attitude, because you mentioned this a couple times, Ann Helen, about positivity and that you choose your frame of reference in mind. the first question is that came from last night. So Helen, you've been so positive through this. You've inspired so many. How do you, when you wake up in the morning with everything going on, and how do you get yourself in the right frame of mind to be positive, to then go out to managers, agents, customers? What do you do? Do you meditate? Do you go for a walk in the morning? Do you look in the mirror and say, you know, like that Stuart Smalley guy, like, I'm wonderful, I'm great, and I'm going to have a fantastic day? What do you do to get your frame of reference going?
Well, I look in the mirror and I say, oh my God, this hair is so terrible. What am I going to do? I tell you what I have done through this. I get up every day, and the first thing I think about is how fortunate we are that this big company, we have had no deaths and we've had very few illness. And that's pretty amazing to me. And that's because of how everybody has acted and together and how we've, you know, how we've followed things. But it's also, I think about just being healthy and doing what we do every day. And so we've had some people in the hospitals. So I look at it that way, as opposed to looking at it as a negative, that we had somebody that got sick last week. Instead, I look at that as a positive. So I think we have to think about that. I get up like any other day, by the way, and I just have to think of what I got to do with the day. I got to look at the calendar, and I have to approach it in a positive way. Was I prepared to do everything on Zoom and Teams? No. And every meeting all of us have is on some kind of virtual network, and some are on WebEx, and some are GoToMeeting, and some are, you know, Get Ready. I mean, there's 10 different ones. And so I look at my calendar this morning and I think, okay, I'm going to do this and this, but I also think about what my goal of having those meetings are. So I don't go to some that I don't need to go to another meeting that's going to tell me that we have to do this, this, or this. I need to go to meetings that are going to make me up and excited. I read the newspapers, but I no longer watch any news channels. If I could tell you anything, I would tell you don't watch any news channels. Doesn't matter which side you're on, just turn them off. If you want to watch the news, turn to the national networks or PBS, because they're not quite as biased, and you just go from one to the other getting, and it's the same information repeated 24 hours a day. So stay away from that. So I think that I talk to my family in the morning, I sit and have coffee with my husband every morning, and we talk about real things in our lives and in the world. And I think those are really good for us. Okay. And I think about what I'm going to cook, which I've never thought about, I don't think, in 30 years.
Made cereal.
Pardon?
Made cereal for dinner.
Cereal for dinner is very good. It's better with champagne than it is with red wine, but we haven't had cereal. I've been making real foods. But I'm saying is you have to focus away from something else, and you have to focus on what we think tomorrow is going to bring, not just today. And so that's what I do. I keep thinking, if we get enough listings, we have enough buyers, I know, because I can look at Home Finder and I can look at Exchange and I can look at the traffic on our website and say, you know, oh, that also gets me really excited when I see how much traffic we've had and I see these virtual open house successes. But it is a decision that I make that I'm going to be good that day.
Yeah, it's funny you say about the news. Mm-hmm. I read something this morning that said, from a friend who sent me an email saying, don't watch the news today, you'll feel better the end of the day. And, you know, just one of those positive, there's a little more to it. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting. You and I talk at least twice a day, most days, if not more. And I would say that I think both of us made a conscious, for most of you understand, Helen and I agree on a lot of things, and we disagree on other things, and we tend to have healthy debate on things. Sometimes we don't always agree politically always. And I think that there was a period of time, probably 4 weeks ago, that we were both, whether it was in the background of our offices at home or in our homes, where we may have had the TV on and we may have been watching different channels just streaming in the background. Mm-hmm. So Helen and I would come at the end of the day and talk and have a very different, and I think the politics we were seeing, whether negativity to either side was allowing us to bring, maybe the whole world's doing this today, to bring too much, but where I think we both, without talking about it, stopped watching the news so much, shut that down so that we could be really take best knowledge of the day, best emotion of the day, and not be not influenced, I guess you'd say, from a perspective that's just talking heads. So I do think that mindfulness of turning off the chatter, turning off the noise, and realizing that people are going to have different perspectives, yeah. but we're all trying to move through this.
But the noise isn't just political. I think that's important too. You know, as I said, right now there's this challenge, the booty question.
Yes. Okay?
It's amazing that how much time we're spending talking about masks, booties, a lot of stuff we never thought we'd have to talk about. Preparation for opening. How many of these plexiglass things do we order for our front desk? But the booty question. So the other day I actually wrote to Pennsylvania Association and I said, can you give me what the wording was that said you have to wear booties, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And they came back to me with, well, it actually says that you have to have foot covering.
Foot, not shoe, foot covering.
Not shoe,
right?
Foot covering, which could mean to me, they said to me, they sent me an email saying shoes, socks, or booties. I said, okay. So this morning they've sent out again for the places that are open, you've got to wear booties. And I just sent back and say, why wouldn't you have just said booties or shoe coverings? Instead, because we're wanting to place on our agents these impossible responsibilities.
Yes.
I mean, not only do you have to learn the virtual tours, you got to be responsible to make sure you have booties, and somebody who comes without them, what do you do? So I think it is not just political stuff.
Right. It blends.
It's everything. It's everything. It blends into it. Yeah. It's everybody wanting to be part of it. It's all the emails you're getting from somebody saying, I can change your life if you try this and you try that. Yeah.
So, but it blends in. Where I'm saying is it blends in because you mentioned the term that was used by one of our agents is haters. The haters have me worried. You and I talked about this last night, the calls you get from agents in different markets saying, I'm afraid to let anybody know that I virtually sold this house because somebody's going to turn me in. The debates talk about shoe covers or foot covers. I hate to even say it. It wasn't shoe cover. That interpretation we had when we were announcing the yellow stage, we had boards of realtors sending out that it's mandated. You must, their interpretation was you had to have booties. And as I said to one of the executive officers of one of those boards, then are you providing them for all of our agents? Because not only did they say that, they said, if somebody doesn't bring booties, let us know because we'll find them. Find them on what merit and what basis? And then agents just started fighting because you brought perspective in and we brought interpretation in. And instead of using common sense and say, well, if I can't get shoe covers, if I want to have booties, if my seller does, what do I say to the seller that says I can't get the shoe cover because I can't find them, but this person wants to see the house? We have to like communicate, maybe have a seller say, hey, they can just come in their socks and take their shoes off, or no, they can't show my house unless you find a booty. We're just going to interpretation and then fighting with our friends and our family members and arguing over because our perspectives are jaded. It's just my only point. And I guess the point is I have two texts from agents. And they're both from Pittsburgh, who just said, I'm worried about the haters.
Yeah, so am I.
So how do we address that, Howard Hanna? How do you address that as a leader in the industry for all these years that some of our, and both agents, I won't say who, both are some of the best agents we have who are worried about haters sending them to losing their license and other things. How do we get over that? Is there any way to get over that?
You know, the haters, whatever, and by the way, it works always. It's not just people hating Howard Hanna is what they mean.
Yeah, I mean, no. It's hating anybody that's working.
No, I think there's jealousy. I think there's haters of people that are working. I think there are always people that look at the dark side of everything. But I will say again that somebody said to me yesterday, are you going to defend me? I said, of course I'll defend you. Now, I don't know what that means because nobody has seen any sanctions that a state has put in. The governor of Pennsylvania 2 weeks ago said he didn't declare lots of this yellow yet. It's almost noon. But he did say, you have to be self-monitoring yourself. But we don't have people. We're not going to go out and arrest people if they don't have a mask on or they don't have booties on. We don't have people to do that. So who's going to be doing this? That's where I don't know. And so, and I think we have to be very careful that we again don't fall in that black hole of those negative people. And we do what we believe is right for us under the regulations. And the regulations were, in many places and still are, you cannot show people, you cannot be one-on-one with people. That's really the answer. That is the same thing most of us are practicing every day. I mean, I'm at work 24 hours a day. I hope I'm doing something, not 24 hours, but I'm not, but I'm not with everybody all the time. I hope, I mean, I'm not seeing people personally, you know? And I think a lot of our sales associates are doing that. I have some friends who are doing real estate right now. Yet, if you said to them, I'm going to drop over and give you something, they would say, stand back, leave it at the end of the driveway, and I'll come out and get it when you're gone. So, but they're doing real estate. So never worry about the haters.
Yep.
That will get you down any day of the week. And for those people in Pittsburgh, call me. Somebody also just sent a chat that said, we have to wear booties to show houses virtually in Pittsburgh.
I think that was a joke.
Well, I was going to say about that because that's across the board though. Only, none of this is by city. It's all by county in some states and by the whole states in other states. So,
right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, switching gears a little bit, and I think it is important we stay positive you have a take on this whole, crisis, around the country, because you talk to so many people around the country. You've been on different national panels. You've had national meetings with whether it's NAR or whether it's Realty Alliance, or last week with Stefan Swampel and his organization. What are you, from your friends, what are you learning about this nationally that our agents could take away that create some value?
Well, I think what I've learned for our agents is that our prices are going up and others are going to fall. Quite honestly, if you talk to the brokers in New York that I spoke to last week, New York City, what they call downstate in New York, their prices are going to fall, and you're already seeing that. They're going to fall in a lot of areas where in clusters, and we're lucky that none of us really live in clusters. We have cities. And we have a downtown life in Cleveland and, you know, around Detroit, and we have one in Pittsburgh and Syracuse, but really we are not that dense urban neighborhoods. So we're not going to see people flocking away. And as a matter of fact, the cities we're in are predicted to pick people up, more people coming to those cities. And I'm hearing this from agents, and I'm also hearing it from a neighbor, that people who are quarantining with families are deciding whether I'm going to stay and live in Cleveland again. I'm not going to go back to Chicago. Am I going to live in Buffalo as opposed to moving back to New York City? So those things all benefit from us. I think that every place is in the same position. Every place in the Midwest, certainly, and the East Coast has a lack of inventory. Those markets that are least affected right now are the ones that have inventory. So when you see states that are down 30%, it's not just that they have less disease, they also have more inventory. So I think that most of us are predicting that we are going to have a great, great late spring, summer market, but if we have the inventory to meet it. And if illness doesn't invade any of our markets primarily again, I think that's important. So I think all of us have learned this great balance. I sit here here I have little hand sanitizers, I have masks. I'll be happy to discuss those with you. I think if we're sensible ourselves, forget what the regulations say, what's sensible for us. So I think you're going to see nationally markets like ours are going to be great. Some of the cluster markets are going to have some problems. I think some of the coastal markets are going to have some problems that you're not going to see people going in and rushing and buying a second home for $4 million in Florida, perhaps this month. But other than that, I think we're safe. Even our unemployment in Pennsylvania is high. It may affect the first time entry level buyer, but it shouldn't affect the other buyer so much, especially as we see people coming back to work. So I'm very bullish on the summer. I don't think anybody would predict beyond that.
Right. Mm-hmm. What about, we have one of our loan officers, Pat Palumbo, said, Helen, agents are being asked to the Daily Sevens and do other things to try to generate business. Do you recommend that their buyers get pre-approved right now with Howard Hanna Mortgage?
Yes, I have been recommending that. Some of the things, I'll tell you what I'm learning is, I mean, it's not just on your office calls, on your cocktail parties and the things that I've been doing. It's also on my one-on-ones with agents who call me. And thank you for, I gotta tell you, I've had calls and notes and emails from people that say, are you okay? And how's the stress? I'm good. Fortunately, I am absolutely great. But I think—
stress on me and her daughter.
That's right. I said that to you the other day. I said that to you. I can relax. You guys have the stress. I don't have it. You know, people that are in marketing and every place else can take it right now. I'll just sit here and look glamorous. But but across the board, that's my choice not to allow myself to get too stressed but about things I can't control. But yes, I have heard that and I have learned it. And there are people in markets, I really learned it from Ohio first, that agents in Ohio where we could show, were not showing. They required that people be pre-approved.
Right.
Okay. Or pre-qualified for their mortgage. I sent this out last week. Duffy was on last week saying that we are here. You know, get your people pre-qualified and get them to do it now so that they're ready to buy. And one of our agents has somebody that they are so far done. They are waiting to come in from out of town to buy a house. And they have everything done except the contract on the house. They know the general price range. They know everything. Their credit stuff's done. They have paid for everything to be done in advance so that they're ready. So I think that it's incredibly important. I also think we hear from a lot of agents that even though they could show, have required people to review the virtual tour first. And a lot of our agents are never again going to run out on demand for somebody that calls and says, show me a house at 2 o'clock. They're going to want a buyer agency form. They're going to want pre-qualification. They're going to want something to verify who those people are. I think we will come out of this much smarter than we have ever been.
Good.
And learn to use our time better. But yes, of course I want you pre-qualified. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So to that point, you know, so a week ago we launched a contest, an activity contest, mm-hmm. Because the senior residential senior team went back and forth. Like, I know what kind of contest they really wanted was a listing contest. However, the feeling was and the sentiment was because of all the different stages of markets that we needed just an activity contest, a contest that you could still have a chance to garner points just for working on getting your contacts into engage, using buy side. Posting to social media, something positive. I mean, a whole series of things. And then we gave bonus points for listings and for sales. Now, it was a simple contest just to have a little fun and little activity and some competition, because some agents have said to me over the past, like Sonia Halstead said, just give me a contest every week. It'll make me do a little something extra. But of course, I got an email here that came in from Adam Kaufman that said it must not be a Helen contest because there's no shoes, there's no purses, that the prizes are only, aren't as exciting as a typical Helen contest. And so he's assuming it wasn't your contest.
It was not. It was not my contest, but it was an activity contest. And I think that's great because I think a lot of us need structure. I mean, I'm amazed how many of you are on Zoom meetings that never go to your office meetings normally. You know, and are on Zoom tours and doing things that you wouldn't have done before. But we all need some structure. That's why I said I have to start with my calendar every day. If I don't look at my calendar, and we have an overlay calendar, that means every meeting, every cocktail party that's been scheduled comes on an overlay. And 3 days ago, I decided to take off the overlay for a couple of days. And, you know, I had to watch a soap opera in the middle of the afternoon because I couldn't watch the news. But Adam, you brought that up, and that's a very good point because I might feel a Helen's whim coming for a listing contest of all things, okay?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, once this contest is over so people don't start sandbagging listings waiting.
No. Once this contest, it has to be a little more fair playing field of agents being able to go on into houses everywhere before I start the contest, or I will spend my entire night telling me it's not fair they didn't win a purse because, you know.
Yeah.
That's a fun idea. Yeah, definitely.
Your pin, Ann Helen, there's a couple people saying, where do I get Helen's pin?
I don't know if we have any more. I don't know who's on the phone right now, but I think it's a great thing. It's my, if you listed it, will sell campaign. We've had it for years. I'll find out how many there are. I'm not sure we have any in stock, but it's a good thing for us to order right now. I will tell you that they're being very tight on my budget expenses as to what I'm allowed to spend. So I'll have to get that approved. So I mean, I've got, you know, I spend my time ordering masks and, you know, booties, et cetera, but
it's come up a couple times and I think you should reference it. The question is the company going to provide masks? Do we have to have masks? How do they get it? I mean, so you've been, your major job has been the procurer of, the PPE
equipment. So let me give you that. We have either in stock at this point or ordered 11,000 masks. We have paper masks. I have samples here of that one here. That the offices will have for emergency masks. And we have them also to order, but we're sending them out to offices. We have Howard Hanna logo masks, which are champions. As we relearn to do everything else, we'll get one in their champions gift. And somebody just told me Target is selling a pack of masks that are one day use ones for $15. I don't know how many that come in that pack, but we have booties. Booties are the hardest thing for us to get. I'm not amazed at this, but I will tell you, if you go to a hospital for any reason right now, we don't recommend you do, but if you have to go get a test or something, they don't have booties on the mat in the hospital. My next door neighbor, I asked him if he had another source for me, because he's a neurosurgeon. Where would he have a source? They only wear them if they are in isolation units or in surgery units. But we're being told that, we're being told to get them. So we're working on that. We don't have enough of those in stock. I will tell you, we have, I think, in stock or on order 1,200 pair, which is the most we could get right now. So if you see them, you should get them. All over chats are coming in right now telling me you can get them. Sherwin Williams has booties and gloves. Good place to check. I'll check those. Buckeye Medical in Cleveland. But yes, we have them. So some of you will be receiving masks from us. The others will be available. I have to say, you know, I say this, this one was made for me by one of our agents in New York who suggested that we put people together to sew these and sell them for an amount of money. That was at the very beginning. That was a pretty expensive process for everybody. And we all thought you had a lot on your plate. But yes, they are. So the first set of masks are in the store now. And all of the employees will get them so that, as I say, those of you that are agents, some of you may be getting them as gifts, some of them you may be buying, some whatever. Yeah. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would say that I'll just add to that, because I know you've put time, is that I've noticed that buddy in my, most people I know have a mask. I mean, because you either, in Pennsylvania, I think you have to, if you go to the grocery store, you have to wear a mask. I know that just in social responsibility, I know most people have masks, that they're put in their back pocket and put when they go in a store. And it all varies by state. And I think most of our consumers will be aware that's part of the process as we open up more. We will have things on our website. We will have on GoHanna. We will have things out there. I just thought I'd add a couple other things that, so our agents know. We've also ordered automatic hand dispenser of Purell and wipes that'll be built in and put into the offices. They're not in yet. They're being shipped because, as you can imagine, I think we ordered them 4 weeks ago, but with everybody trying to order these. So there are some permanent things we're putting in place in the branches. And we are right now continuing to have our administrative staff work remotely, even in the markets that have that we can open up and have them come back, only because for multiple reasons, we want to make sure that the offices are staffed and secured with the right hand sanitizers, masks, everything that we need, but also because we don't want everybody to feel pressure right away to come back. We know people have different concerns and we just want them to, they're able to support us. We want to keep that in place right now. I mentioned that because there's a lot of things that may change. I've seen this, like somebody just, there was one chat in here said, Zoom meetings are great. Do you think we can continue it even when offices open back up? And And how will we deal with social distancing in branches and on showing of customers, and will live open houses change, and will these virtual tours stay? And so, Ann Helen, sort of from your perspective and your wisdom, I think that there's going to be some things that go back to the way they were. And I think that there are going to be some things that are learning in this last 6 weeks, 2 months, whatever it may be, that might be the new way that we are offering to the customer to do business. What's your take on that? Do you think it's all going to go back to normal once?
No. I think this is normal changes, doesn't it? And I think normal has changed and will change for the future. I think, I think our clients are going to demand different, not more, but different. I mean, I said this morning that virtual tours, you know, they're 2 minute ones. They're like teasers. There are 8 minute ones that are long, and it may become the norm that we all have to learn to edit. I think I sent to Jackie and Kate this morning that I think we need some classes that go beyond just creating a quick virtual tour for people to learn how to do things themselves, and how can we help them, and what can we do for them, and what resources do we have? Because I do think they're going to want more than just seeing that cursory version of the house. And I think buyers and sellers, and if you're going on a listing today and you're not telling sellers about all of the programs that you have, all of the ways you have to market, then I think that's a disadvantage also. But I do think that we got to consider all of the good stuff that's come out of this. I mean, I'm seeing people and meeting people online right now that have never heard my voice before. They've seen my writings, right? And, you know, I'll try to connect back with as many of you as possible, but you've seen my writing, you send me emails, but you know, you might not have heard my voice because I haven't been at your meeting or I haven't been in an award ceremony with you. And I think that's great, because I think it's also true in offices, by the way, that you're seeing people, then in a world where we're running around, we're seeing each other. I think the mothers, I can't even begin when I talk to you mothers of 5-year-olds, 7-year-olds, 9-year-olds, and you're doing classes. And I know you're not on here today because you've got school in regular hours, because they're giving structure to it. I think all of you are learning so much right now. And that's why I'm saying, I don't think we'll go back to just running out and showing a house, because we found more balance in our lives. Surprisingly, this little break period is teaching us that there is more balance, that a lot of the stuff we did before, we didn't need to do. And so I think it is changed. I think it is going to be changed for the better. And I think that's important. I go back in all my years in real estate, every time there's been a new agreement, everybody complain about why we've added a page or why we've added this. But in the end, we are all better because of it, even though it's too many pages. Right? Each change that we've had, so a lot of the old stuff will be gone. But from it, we have all learned so much. And I would also have to say, because the other thing that I'm trying to do now is that I'm trying to go back and look at all the things that I've missed. And I mentioned this to Hobie about our young mothers, that we got to sort of package stuff for them maybe, rather than just going to the links, because this is school time. So they don't get to hear these, or they don't get to go to their office meetings. So if we can do some of those for them for when they've got time on their own and kids have gone to bed, that they can jump in on. So yes, I think the future is better. I think it is brighter. It certainly is brighter because it's getting warmer, but I think it's also brighter because of all of the things that we had that we weren't using that now we can. So,
I agree, Ann Helen. That's great answer to that, because I think, and that's one of those things that I think even as agents and individuals, we've just got to get our heads wrapped around that. Make what decisions of how we're going to conduct our business and listen to our clients and customers, without getting overwhelmed, because it seems to appear to be technology. It's always my fear is that, you know, how many people would have never used Zoom or Microsoft Teams? I mean, we've been paying as a company for Microsoft Teams for 2 years, and I think only the IT department used the platform. And now I would say the whole company is leveraged around how to communicate this way. Agents are now communicating with their customers with FaceTime or Zoom or live, you know, even pre-qualifying live and having discussion before you jump in your car and show people. So it's not all technology. It's just sometimes things are forced upon us just to change, you know, who would imagine that we'd all have one of these 20 years ago, that a mini computer in our hand. So I just think that if you're overwhelmed because you think it's all going to be virtual and technology and change, I wouldn't do that to yourself. Learn a little bit, still know that the agent having the data and the knowledge and the communication and the patience and the negotiation skills are going to what's be needed in our business. And I just think that's important as we move forward.
Can I add to that though? Because that's been a topic of conversation on national meetings I've had and in a big interview I did last week. And that conversation was really about how much communication we're doing. And that was a decision that we made, I think, the first state that was closed. We're going to over-communicate. People don't come on, that's fine. They don't have to listen, but we're going to over-communicate. And I think that has surprised people across the country, other brokers and national news media, how much time we are all on here, spending our time talking to people, being with everybody, because we think that's important. But I think all of you, or not all of you, but many of you have been doing this because you've had kids out of town, your sister's out of town, your mother lives someplace else. You've been doing this for years on Facebook. You've been doing it for years when you did your Facebook Live open houses. You were doing it when you talk on your phone and you look at each other with, I hate that, whatever that's called. That's not Facebook. That's FaceTime. FaceTime, sorry, because I always look awful on FaceTime pictures. But but you know.
Your brother thinks FaceTime is the greatest thing ever. He just won't talk to you on a phone anymore. He always clicks the FaceTime and I'm like, Dad, I go, I've been on a Zoom camera all day. Can you and I just talk without having to stare at you? So
yes, but I think my brother is a great example. He's also on Facebook now. He's on there if you want to friend him. But the point of it being, we were all doing it in little pockets of different things that we were doing. And now we're realizing the power that we had and the potential of that power.
Right.
And we should never forget that it's not just to talk to your friends you went to college with. It's to talk to clients in a room like this. I mean, just imagine looking at the house that somebody's living in before they start looking with them on Zoom, before they move to your city, they're coming from another city, having them walk through the house and tell them what's good and bad about it. I've talked about for years on Home Finder on TV. It's why it's a great show, because they actually look at where somebody's living to understand what they're looking for. So a great deal of power at our fingertips that we had only barely touched.
Great. So we're sort of up against our time and we're, you know, dropping off here with some folks just because they have other things. Couple just, you know, I'll sort of end with your point. If you're talking to your friends in the office, managers who are on this or loan officers, remind those agents that, like Helen said, a lot of moms who are doing and dads who are helping with some homeschooling right now with their kids. I know mine are upstairs and, you know, who knows when they may show up right here. We're all managing that. And we maybe can't at a 10 o'clock webinar be live and watch it. We maybe miss something that's a training webinar at 1 p.m. because these are difficult times. But those of you that are here, and some of you are regularly on here, you know, reach out to your friends in the office that you know are there, the managers and loan officers, make sure you talk to those agents. All of these webinars we do are recorded, and then posted, and we refer them on at the Town Square newsletters. There's links that you can go directly to them. Helen's right, we'll put some packaging together for people so it's all in one place. Everything's out there. Everything from day one that we've done, we've recorded, and it's accessible for all of our agents. And just to go back and review or hear something you missed. So please just we'll do a better job of communicating this there, but share out with your friends that they don't have to miss it. They could go watch the recorded version. So, Ann Helen, usually on these, as we wrap up, and we've had agent panels and we've had, you know, folks like Real Scout, I sort of end with three questions, and usually it's two. I'm going to give you three. We discussed a lot of things this morning. If there was one piece of advice that you'd like everybody in the company to take away, that is, you think your best piece of advice in this market and this time for our agents, what would that be?
My best piece of advice would be to use some of the exciting, positive pieces that we have out there. I think we need to shift from the wonderful things you were posting with the messages about, you know, stay well, stay healthy, to, you know, there is a world in front of us and how can we help you? I got one from Tom Simon this morning that it was just a piece that we have. It's our Go Faster. And it was saying, we can't do everything, but we're here to help you. I think psych yourself first and then go and look at those things to send out. Number two, I would say, get up every morning and go to work. It's no different than it always does. Those that go to work succeed. Great. Those would be my strongest pieces of advice. And
okay. Second question is, I ask this of all of our agents. So I'll ask it of you. What is the one thing the company, the management, the department, the family, what's the one thing that we're not doing that you'd like to see us do to support you in this time?
It's an odd question.
Well, most people answer, you're doing everything wonderfully, Hobie. There's nothing I can tell you.
Yeah. Can I reverse this and say what I'm proudest of what we've done?
Okay. That's fair. Okay. Yep.
And it's, I'm proudest of the employees that we have that, quite honestly, to ask for a virtual open house rider would have taken a month to even get a design back 2 months ago. And you know, you get it in 3 days. It's just been great. But I'm most proudest of, our commitment to our staff and our agents to the best of our ability. When we made the decision to extend income advantage to our agents, it was a very big decision. It was not one that our banks would have agreed with, by the way. It was not one probably that our CFO agreed with the first day, but I am very proud that we did it immediately. It wasn't one from later. And the second one is, I am, people all over their country are amazed that we're pushing the money back guarantee. And again, that onus is on us. And agents ask me all the time, can other brokers, why can't we use it in other companies' listings or why can't they get it? Sure, if they want to share in the risk, we'll be happy to do it. But I doubt you're going to find people to share in the risk. We never have been able to. So I'm proud of our management team that really came to us. They were the ones that came to us and said, we need to bring it back strong. And I'm proud of everybody else for agreeing it was the time. So those two things make me personally proud that we made that commitment to you, to our sellers, and to our buyers, because I don't know if the market's going to fall or stay strong, but I know that we're saying we're guaranteeing it. So, yes.
So, okay, last question for you, which I sort of off of John Kennedy's quote, because I always ask the agents what we can do for them, but I'll ask you. Not just what the company can do, but what can our agents do to help the company grow right now?
I think stay focused. Don't let outside forces affect what you're doing. It would be the number one. Again, I would go back to look at the programs and see if you're using all of the tools you have. Because we're going to come out of this, and I can tell you, there are going to be discounters out there saying, we're not going to charge you. We just want to get market share credit. And I mean, it's crazy in New York, some of the stuff that has happened, really, that, you know. And I look at that, and I say that I think we have to take a different attitude than that. We say what we mean, and we speak what we mean. And that's what, by the way, that's what our vision, our mission, and our values are all about. They're not about doing something and saying something different. So, but I think you have great tools available to you. And if we're not giving you help to use them, then you need to call us. Just as I said this morning, somebody said we need more training on advanced virtual tour techniques. That's what we need to hear from you. But also we need you to take what's out there and use it to expand your business opportunities, especially for the next 4 months ahead of us.
That's great. And Helen, thank you. Reading this, I know that everybody appreciates the time that you give us all every day, leading the company, but thank you for coming on this morning and just your words of inspiration and wisdom, I think will help everybody. To everybody out there, thank you for coming on to the town hall webinar. I hope you see value in these. Obviously with the attendance, you're enjoying it. But I'll just conclude, we're all moving at the speed of light to support everybody. But if you feel alone, if you feel stressed out, I don't care if you're a manager, agent, loan officer, employee, this network, this is a family business, and we're all here to support everybody. So we'll get through all this, and you know, we're one day closer to being on the other side, whatever that means now. But thank you for all you do. Thank you for making this company so special, everybody on this webinar and everybody at Howard Hanna. And have a great weekend. And
happy Mother's Day.
Yes, I forgot about that. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. I better remember that I got to make sure everybody got their Mother's Day gifts in this house. So at least
the only one. Call your mother,
but I got four kids that all need to.
And mother-in-laws too. Some I read that this morning.
My mother, my aunts who are mothers. It's Happy Mother's Day to everybody out there. Okay.
Thanks, everybody.
All right. Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Thanks, Aunt Helen. Kate, thanks. And Lauren and Kevin, thank you. And so we'll get, I know there were more questions on the tech side than usual, Kate, but if we can still, so I think there were some good ones there. So if we can still, you know, pull them together and that way we can.
Yeah, I'm making the FAQ like as we speak. I'm trying to get it out this afternoon.
I know you are. So thank you for everything and we'll talk soon. Okay.
All right. Thanks, Hobie.
Thanks, Lauren. Great job. Thanks, Kevin.
Thanks. Bye.
Thanks.